Love it. All right, so before we begin, I do want to share a quick land acknowledgement. So as a settler on this land and on behalf of Meads, I would like to acknowledge the Indigenous peoples of all the lands that we are calling in from today. Our so-called Canada is built upon the unceded, unsurrendered ancestral territory of the Inuit, Métis, and First Nations people that call this land home. These unceded and unsurrendered lands were often taken through violent, non-consensual means, and colonial violence persists in our society today. So we stand in solidarity with Indigenous peoples across Turtle Island as they fight for their rights, recognition, and representation. With a lot of us being settlers on this land, it's crucial that we recognize the power structures and our own positionality and our own commitments towards truth and reconciliation. So land acknowledgements like this are only a very, very small part of the lifelong individual and collective and constantly evolving journey we all have to take towards truth and reconciliation. So we ask that you take time on your own to reflect on your own experiences, positionality, and spaces, and what you can do in your personal life to honor truth and reconciliation. To learn more about the land you are on, I will be posting a link to native-land.ca. It is definitely not comprehensive, but it is an excellent place to start. All right, and I will just be posting that in the chat right now. So this is the part where I do opening remarks. So thank you everyone for joining us today on, I almost said Wednesday, it's Friday apparently. So we're really, really excited to host Invisible Institutions for this virtual access for all webinar discussing institutionalization practices and the future of care. This webinar is part of our larger Virtual Access for All series funded by Employment and Social Development Canada, which consists of our quarterly State of the Schools reports by the incredible Elizabeth Moeller, financial assistance through the Accessibility Resilience Program and Meads Student Awards Program, the maintenance of our Breaking It Down employment website and disabilityawards.ca, and Meads' upcoming hybrid Cross Canada State of the Schools tour. So before I hand it over to the panel, a quick introduction of our speakers. Megan Linton is a PhD student, writer, and researcher challenging disability institutionalization and its profit-based motivations, most notably through the incredible Invisible Institutions podcast. Keely Grossman is a sociology PhD student and disability activist at Carleton U. Her master's thesis recollected her experiences of girlhood at residential schools for the blind. And Michael Baker is a K-12 educator, PhD candidate, and sessional lecturer at the University of Manitoba, a member of the City of Winnipeg's Human Rights Committee and its Inclusion and Accessibility Subcommittee Chair. And finally, our moderator, Elizabeth Moeller, works as a research consultant at Meads, conducts PhD research at Western University on the direct funding of self-directed attendance services, and is a very cool coworker. And with that, I will hand it off to you.
Thank you so much, Carly, for the introduction and welcome everyone. Before we get into things, I do want to take a moment to just offer a trigger warning. This topic, as you probably saw from the post on Facebook or wherever you registered, is quite heavy and it's quite weighted. And I just want to hold space for that. If people need to leave for a few moments, that's understandable. If this isn't feeling right for you today, absolutely understandable if you need to step away. Please take care of yourself. Self-care is really important. Myself, I'll be around for a few minutes after if folks just want to chat informally, but I do want to open with that because it's a heavy topic. So with that, I'd like to pose the first question to the panel. And that is, in your opinion, why have people with disabilities been institutionalized? And in what ways are people still being institutionalized today? And I'm going to start with Megan.
Hi, thanks so much for having us today. I'm really looking forward to this discussion. People with disabilities have been institutionalized across Canada almost since its inception. Where I'm calling from in Ontario, it began in 1876, but it has been a long process since then. But largely, institutionalization really boils down to, you know, what this country was colonized for, and the process of colonization itself, which is the introduction of capitalism and its desire and need to have people either working or removed from society. And so I think people have been institutionalized historically for many different reasons. Most of them boil down to eugenics, which is the belief that people who are in quote unquote inferior should be eradicated through any amount of state engagement. And so institutionalization really started because of capitalism, but then the real growth of eugenics through the 19th century and the development of large-scale institutions, like particularly the really large ones across Canada, were used for decades and centuries. And in some places, like where Michael's calling from in Winnipeg, they still are operating. But today, in Ontario, where I'm calling from, many of those large institutions have been converted or closed, but we still see the mass institutionalization of disabled people through places like long-term care homes, which people are being sent to from hospitals now without their consent. Places like supported living institutions. Today, the front page of the Toronto Star was an investigation into one of these models of housing, domiciliary hostels, which we follow in the podcast. But any amount of large and small scale institutions continue to force people with disabilities inside. I think I'll pass it over to Michael before I get carried away.
No, but thank you. That was great. And that was a really important synopsis of the how and now where we're at today. So Michael, I'll pass the torch over to you. Same question. And looking at why in the past have we been institutionalized and in what ways are we still being institutionalized today?
Sure. Thank you so much. First, I just want to thank everyone for giving me this opportunity to participate. So institutionalization, I think, building on what Megan was saying, which is she covered a lot, is to control an unwanted other. I'm going to put that obviously into quotations. And there's a direct connection between residential schools and the institutionalization of people with disabilities. And I think it was to create a specific type of citizen of settler. That's one major reason. Other than what Megan had said, was to simply control people and to monitor, categorize, isolate, marginalize those deemed and other, and that continues today. Without going too much about in what ways people are still experiencing institutionalized today, but I think a major avenue of institutionalization today is through public education. Which is I think we're going to talk about that in the second question. So I'm just going to leave it at that and pass it on to the next speaker. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Keely. And just to recap the question in case it's helpful for folks, looking at why have we been institutionalized and in what ways are we still being institutionalized today? So over to you.
Hi. So thank you so much for having me. And it's really great to be here today and to have this opportunity. And just to expand a bit on the last couple of points. So I think that institutionalization has happened historically for a number of reasons, like the fact that disabled people, people with disabilities have often been viewed as like having an unwanted difference, of which historically there's been a lot of medicalization of the disability community, which, as Megan mentioned, is still very present today. And the kind of type of institutionalization that I more so focus on is residential schools for the blind. And so different types of institutions have existed for multiple reasons, like colonialism, racism, classism, and ableism. But the kind of historical part of residential schools for the blind itself and its relationship to the blind community has to do with number one, medicalization and removing the blind and visually impaired people from the community, but also unlike maybe some other disability communities, there was a lot of focus historically on vocational training and teaching skills when students would attend residential schools for the blind. And so today there are still residential schools for the blind. There are about 30 in the United States, and there is only one in Canada that remains.
Thank you so much. That was a great overview. And you've led us nicely into our next question, which is, how do institutionalization and the education system intersect, and how are they intertwined? And I will start again at the top with Megan.
Yeah, so such an important intersection of the institutionalization and education is the education system. And so when institutions were developed in Canada, of course, many of them were called training schools or industrial schools, and maybe changed eventually to hospital schools before they were called regional centers. And so the education system, when it began, was actually a really important component of expanding the institutionalization system. And so Madeline Burkhart, who's an institutional historian, does a really good job going over this. But when public education began, they were really able to use it as a mechanism to segregate and separate out disabled children and forcibly institutionalize them into large-scale institutions. And so we see, of course, that this is like a really important mark. The education system is a really important marker for institutionalization, and really provides like a pathway and in these cases, like direct intervention gateway into institutions. And then the early institutions, such a big part of them was their importance of education, but the education that was so often given to disabled people was just labor, was just learning how to do manual labor and work, and particularly highly gendered forms of labor, like working in the laundry in the kitchen or working in the fields. And so as a result, you know, we see these really important intersections where institutions are supposed to be forms of education, but of course, those forms of education are highly gendered, and then once more, highly classed, where you're only really learning how to do specific tasks or chores that you're never going to fully get paid for. And I'm going to pass it over to Michael now, because I feel like he should take a bit more time on this question.
For sure. Thank you so much. So, Michael, you know, how do institutionalization and education, how are they intertwined? How do they intersect?
Okay. So I'm going to talk about, I'm a K-12 educator. And so I'm going to talk about lived experience. I'm going to talk about my role in a Manitoba context. But through research, I can tell you the context is almost identical to every other province in and territory in Canada. And so institutionalization and education today, because Megan did fill us in on kind of those early foundation, today are highly connected. And so we kind of have moved a little bit beyond the physical borders of institutionalization, although, as Megan pointed out, Manitoba still operates formal institutions. But saying that, the education system today is really it carries out a form of what is called, I think in research, is trans-institutionalization. And that's the current form that we institutionalize people with disabilities. And so what happens is a student, or actually a child, is registered in their local public school. And immediately they're identified, whether that's through school, like through school personnel or other, immediately identified as having a disability. And from that point on, for the rest potentially for the rest of their life, moving past education, they are marked as someone for institutionalization with kind of beyond borders. And so how that works is once a student has this marker, as Megan described, they are systematically excluded from earning regular credits. So they can attend any classroom that they like. Usually schools will promote that they're inclusive. And so it's not necessarily the space that isn't inclusive, but the system isn't inclusive, and it actually operates within a systematic ableist model. And so those students are monitored by a variety of professionals as they move through elementary school, middle school, and then they get to high school. And what actually happens in high school is, and it's published, it's on, you know, many board, like school board websites, is they're considered, they no longer benefit from curriculum. So they're considered outside of the curricular purview. They are identified as kind of this subgroup, which is discriminatory in nature, and it's hard to actually understand how this continues, but they're kind of identified as this subgroup that operates outside of curriculum. And within high school, they're identified as a modified student or an individualized student in the Manitoba context. And so what happens is that if you're a modified student, you can actually earn credits. But when you graduate, although you graduate with a diploma, beside each course, it has a little M. And that little M systematically excludes you for life, forever attending a college or a university in Canada or the United States. Individualized students are not allowed to earn credits. So they're systematically excluded. And although they follow the government program, working through high schools and taking courses, they actually are excluded from earning a high school diploma. So they actually earn, and it's not widely publicized, but they don't earn a diploma in any sense. They earn a certificate of completion that is often generated in Microsoft Word by the local school. And so it's completely not recognized at all. And so what happens is that these students, being marked from an early age, come through the system, come through high school, and as Megan alluded to, are really connect to this idea of labor. And so I'm sure everyone has heard these terms, life skills, programming, or special needs, or exceptional student. And what these clinical markers or the clinical gaze actually is excluding those students from actually ever holding a job. So what happens is that once they graduate, they are transitioned into shelter workshops or day programs. As kind of recourse to this, if they ever do hold a full-time job, the government in Manitoba, it's actually $200 a month. So if you earn more than $200 a month, your services and financial funding are cut on a sliding scale. And so you no longer become eligible for any services or service provision, any accessible anything if you engage in labor. So what you basically are forced to do once you move past high school is transition into a sheltered workshop and day program forever. And any kind of kickback from that, any type of, you know, protest to that is kind of met with swift and serious consequences on the government's fault. And so, you know, students have separate streams and systems that lead into institutionalization, separate programming. In the United States, they call it kind of this separate but equal narrative. It's not equal at all in Canada, and nor is it actually published to be so. It's quite explicit in government documents, especially inclusion documents across Canada, that it is separate and that these students are supposedly cannot benefit from curriculum and are outside of the system. There's separate sports, classes, opportunities, and freedoms. that students with disabilities incur. There's curricular negation, as I said. There's no curriculum out there that the people with disabilities can partake in. There's separate reporting systems. So students with disabilities don't actually receive a report card in the same way that their peers do. They receive a separate report card. And there's a negation of high school diploma. They don't earn a high school diploma that the same as their peers, which if you read the Charter of Rights simply, it would seem that it actually is outright discriminatory, but somehow it continues today. There's an intensified monitoring system. People with disabilities are monitored very, very heavily by professionals or medicalization throughout their term. There's a lot of curative or make normal services and research that schools engage in as part of governmental institutionalization. The clinical gaze, as Michel Foucault described, is very prevalent in schools and leads to optimization of control of people with disabilities. And there's coerced transition, as I described, where there is definitely a recourse if a person with a disability wants to go their own way, wants to pursue labor, wants to pursue a career, service provision and financial funding is cut drastically. And now we've all seen the enactment of MAID and these things that are coming forth from the Liberal government with changing MAID. And in March, it'll be anyone with a diagnosis of having a mental illness will be able to access MAID. And the next thing that's under parliamentary review is mature minors. And so people with disabilities now are it's very scary, are almost being encouraged to access MAID, as we've seen in reports throughout the news. But the very scary part is bringing MAID into the schools. And actually last year, the Ethics Bowl, one of the questions was, for all of Canada actually, was dealing with MAID. And Heidi Jantz from the University of Calgary actually weighed in because they asked high school students, able-bodied high school students, to debate whether people with disabilities should just kill themselves, which is, it's mind blowing, but unfortunately, it's accepted. It's acceptable practice. And we see inclusive education today doesn't include disability studies and doesn't include people with disabilities at the decision-making table. So
thank you. Those really so many important points. I just want to make sure that Keely, you have a chance to weigh in on this question about how education and institutionalization are intertwined and intersect.
Yeah, thank you so much. I've learned so much. And so from a blind perspective, perspective of the blind and visually impaired community and residential schools for the blind, I think that a lot of people in the blind and visually impaired community are pushed out of mainstream schools through lack of resources, so lack of access to educational assistance, lack of access to Braille itinerant teachers, lack of access to orientation and mobility, so learning how to use, for example, the white cane, lack of access to assistive technology. And so I think that that's what pushes a lot of young people out of mainstream education and into the provincial residential school for the blind system. And I also think that there's also factors of being around peers that are also part of the blind and visually impaired community. So that mainstream system may be alienating. Through the kind of ableism that exists within mainstream education, blind and visually impaired people are pushed out and kind of at least in the Ontario context and in places and in the US where it's more prominent, because Ontario is the only province that has residential school for the blind in Canada. And then again, in the States, there are 30 of them. So that's where like it's most relevant. So those are kind of like the main factors that interconnect the education system and institutionalization for the blind and visually impaired community.
Thank you so much. Great examples. So our next question really focuses on the education system and kind of revisioning or reimagining what would it look like to have an education system without institutionalization or institutional pathways? And we'll start with Megan again.
Yeah, I mean, I think an educational system without institutional pathways would be one that fundamentally includes disabled people. And I think that in order for an education system to exist without the sway or pull of institutions, we first need to get rid of so many of the models within our education system and so many really of the like therapeutic abuses that are so maintained through the education system. I'm thinking particularly about how like one of the last remaining institutions in Manitoba has on its campus an ABA school. And so of course, when we have a segregated school on the campus of an institution, even when that institution is going to close, the school will remain open. And we see that so often when institutions close, like when the institutions closed in Ontario for people with developmental disabilities, many others of them remained open, like the Child Parent Resource Center in London, Ontario. So I think as long as we maintain ableist ethics and ableist logics that really push for and rely on productivity and perfection and production as the modes of the primary logics and the primary modes of evaluation, and I think we'll be stuck in this institutionalized education system. Beyond that, I mean, I think there's some really important steps that need to be made even today, which would be things like bringing masks back to our education system. Because right now we once more have a segregated education system where immunocompromised kids aren't able to go to public schools and public universities as well. And so there's lots of ways we can make less institutional education systems, but I think we have to fundamentally grapple with the logics of capitalism that our education system is so based around, and particularly what it looks like to be a student in class. Like, are you allowed to be disruptive? Are you allowed to be bouncing around? Is your learning style going to be included if you're someone who's a tactile thinker or someone who is more able to learn when everything is really quiet, where the lights are lower or there's different lighting levels? So I think there's a lot of different possibilities for how we can create an education system beyond institutionalization, but simply closing institutions, simply bringing ending special ed programs won't be enough to end that system of institutionalization. But there's so many steps we can take along the way.
Thank you, Megan. That was such great concrete examples. So again, Michael, revisioning and thinking, what would an education system look like without institutions or institutional pathways?
So first I'd like to kind of pose the question to Megan is, will MDC actually close? Will the mental developmental center actually close? I'm highly skeptical. I don't care what the government says. Oh, we're going to close in a few years. I don't believe, like, I honestly do not believe that, knowing the structure of where it is in Port of Prairie and this idea of like employment and community connection to that institution. I am highly skeptical, but I hope it does. I hope it does close. Okay, so I agree with what Megan had said. This is a very hard question because the current education system operates and is so entrenched in systematic ableism and structural ableism that to answer this question perfectly would say to dismantle and bring something different back. But working in the system, concrete examples that could change, that would change or had the potential to change people's life would be simply, if someone attends a public school and attends a program in the public school, everyone should graduate with a diploma. Everyone should be eligible to find a job if they want to without recourse. Everyone should be able to participate in sports if they want to without being segregated. There's a lot of things that could happen that are concrete and would change people's life, but don't. They don't. And they don't because that's the system that we operate under, and it's very top down. It's very ableist. It's very maintain the status quo. And it takes a lot of fighting to get through that kind of stuff, to have those conversations with stakeholders. It's a constant battle, especially in the language that we use. And another concrete example that I'm working through right now is what does inclusive language look like? It doesn't look like special ed. It doesn't look like special. It does look like having the disability community, having critical disability studies integrated into inclusive education pedagogy, into the ideology. And unfortunately, we're at a place where educators have never heard of the social model versus the medical model. And that is so old, 1970s, like it is, we are so behind that to me, a concrete example would be bring disability studies into inclusive education, mesh those two together and see what we get. Teach educators disability studies. And I do that. I teach disability studies to educators at the University of Manitoba. And every educator, it blows their mind. It's like, how could we still be doing this? Once it's pointed out, it's right there. But once it's pointed out, everyone can't believe it. And the course has had such great feedback with course evaluations because it's so obvious once it's shown to you. So those are some concrete examples from my perspective that we could do that could kind of bring us out a little bit of that institutional thought and grounded in institutionalizations. We could kind of pull back from there. So that's just a few examples. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And Keely, over to you, just looking at the education system and how might we envision removing institutional pathways and practices and institutionalization from the education system?
Yeah, so I think that it's really interesting because a lot of the blind and visually impaired community is pushed out of mainstream schooling to go to residential schools for the blind for better access to having Braille textbooks, et cetera. So we need, first of all, we need access to accessible formats in schools, including readily accessible Braille materials, readily accessible alternative format materials. So screen reader accessible books for those who use the computer. We also need, I think, more opportunities in general, because there's that push for that if you attend a residential school for the blind, you're going to get a better academic curriculum, and that's not necessarily the case in all contexts. So you may have access to Braille textbooks and all the all the materials that you need in the format you need them, but you may not have access to some of the curriculum that, or some of the classes that you may get access to in a public mainstream high school. Another thing is that a lot of blind and visually impaired people don't get proper, for example, sex education in mainstream schools. And I think that's also, that would also apply to other disability communities as well. And at residential schools for the blind, at least what I found in my research was that they were also not getting adequate, for the most part, not getting adequate sex education. And so I think that what needs to happen is that there not only needs to be more accessible formats and materials in accessible formats, such as Braille and screen reader accessible, but also there needs to be more opportunities for blind and visually impaired community to participate in mainstream school activities, whether that's extracurricular, sex education, et cetera. There also needs to be more community building because again, one of the push factors is being around other blind and visually impaired peers to attend a residential school for the blind. So I think building community both between disability communities as much as possible when they're in the mainstream setting and between disability communities and their able-bodied peers would be an empowering kind of way to kind of keep blind and visually impaired people in mainstream schooling and out of institutions. And again, just greater access to extracurricular and curricular activities as well. So basically working towards leveling the playing field and investing into the blind and visually impaired community more, particularly in elementary and high schools to keep them out of institutions.
Thank you so much. And what needs to be done to support greater choice and autonomy for people with disabilities to live and work and study outside of institutions? So Megan, we'll start back up with you.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the most important mechanisms to expand choice and autonomy would be to give people more money immediately. The impact of poverty on access to freedom, to access to autonomy, to access to care is so pervasive and so significant that as long as we maintain rates of ODSP, rates of Manitoba disability payments, AISH, all of the payment systems across Canada at their current levels, we're going to have people forced into situations they don't want to be in. And I think one of the most tangible ways to look at this right now is looking at the forced institutionalization of people who are in hospital, because when in Ontario, if you have been in a hospital and require alternate levels of care, you can be charged up to $300 a day for refusing to be moved to a long-term care facility that is can be anywhere. And so we see that with the price point, with the like enforcement and with the privatization of all of these services, that people are really being forcibly institutionalized in so many different ways. We see this in long-term care, but we also see it in the prison system. My research focuses a lot on the developmental disability service system. And we know that people with developmental disabilities or people labeled with developmental disabilities are removed of autonomy as soon as they're given that label. And so as soon as we begin the labeling process, we're taking away people's choices and we're taking away people's autonomy. And so I think, you know, it goes as far as rethinking diagnosis all the way to like really practical mechanisms like increasing rates of pay, increasing disability support payments. But fundamentally, at the end of the day, we all need access to money to survive. We need access to the care we need to survive. And we need access to the housing we need to survive. And right now, as soon as we take away any of those elements, we are forcing people into a life without autonomy and into a life without choice. The last thing I'll say here is just that not only do we need to be giving people more money, we need to be giving our systems so much more money, because even if you have an increased disability support plan or welfare rates, if there's no healthcare, if there's no access to healthcare, if there's no access to chronic pain care, if there's no access to COVID supports or protections, then there isn't going to be access to autonomy. There's not going to be access to choice, and there isn't going to be really freedoms for people to live the life they want to live.
Thank you. And Michael, what needs to be done to support choice and autonomy for people with disabilities to live, work, and study outside of institutions?
Okay, this is not fair because Megan was so thorough there.
Okay, are we wanting a pass?
No, I did want to add one thing, and that was, I think that what's really connected to communities of care would also be engaging the public in attitudinal struggle, in really engaging those people. I'm obviously biased. I'm an educator in education that teaches a different way to view and value people, to, you know, address hate speech. Disability hate speech is pervasive in public school systems, the R word, et cetera, et cetera. And so I think on top of what Megan said, I think engaging in attitudinal struggle, you know, you see a lot of connection between bell hooks writing and people with disabilities in Canada today. And so I think changing people's attitude, engaging in that type of curricular endeavor would really, really significantly add and build upon a community of care. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And Keely.
Yeah, so I think that, I think what has just been said has basically articulated everything that there is to say, but I think that investing in people staying in mainstream schooling is really important, and having the supports that they need is really important, because you know, like when you attend a residential school for the blind, for example, like you have to leave home from Sunday till Friday, and you know, some people start there pretty young, and there's a lot of inequalities that happen within those institutions, especially because there's really no accountability. There's really no accountability mechanisms, or you know, oversight the way that there could be. And so I think that the key is really investing into people having the supports that they need to be able to be like in mainstream schooling.
Thank you so much. Really important points. You know, mainstreaming, I'm hearing a lot about streaming today, some themes running throughout. I want to ask about sort of reimagining, revisioning. And if we were to do that, what could communities of care look like for all of us, not just folks with disabilities? And Megan, I'll go back to you.
Yeah, it's always so exciting to think about communities of care, because I think that so much of the work that we do is, when you study institutionalization, is really stuck in the really horrible realities of where we are. And I think often it seems like a radical position to say that there shouldn't be any institutions. But when you are faced with the reality of it day in and day out, it becomes so evident that the only thing radical would be to maintain the status quo, to maintain institutions the same way that they are. And so we need to rethink and we need to dream about communities of care. When I think about and dream about them, I'm excited because right now we don't have a world where disabled people are in it. For so many of us, this means that right now our communities don't have disabled people because we have decided disabled people can be left alone through the COVID pandemic and left to fend for themselves. And so communities of care would look like communities where we are prioritizing access, where we are prioritizing safety. So this would mean no policing and no preventing people from engaging in our community because of who they are or because of what we deemed the risks that they pose. And so I think this would mean providing paid opportunities for care that are equitable and just and would allow for people to choose care, to choose that they want to be in the care economy because it's a good job and not because it's the only job that will provide like whatever. Sorry, had a little brain fart there, but we need to provide care work that is just, that is equitable, and that is like funded enough. We need to have communities where you're not just valued for what you produce. And so as a result, that means having really robust recreational and like leisure activities. That means that we're not leaving people alone. And I think one of the biggest parts about that be having intergenerational communities where disabled and non-disabled people are working together to feed each other, to have clean homes, to have clean air, and to make sure that we have what we need to survive. And so I think that'll be radically rethinking our economies and radically rethinking our community systems so that it's not just a single nuclear family that's caring for someone, but rather like an entire ecosystem of care that starts with the most marginalized and includes everyone along the way.
Thank you so much. And I just want to note before I move on to Michael that Frank has said care should be self-managed by those who are receiving it. So I just wanted to note that from the chat. And Michael, reimagining what could communities of care look like?
Well, I totally agree with Frank said and Megan. I don't know why guaranteed income is so radical. There would be a lot more power. That power differential would begin to shift, I think. And so a community care has guaranteed income, that's a living, I know this is not the right word, but a living wage, right? A living proportion. People with disabilities should be in valued positions, and for me, visibility is very, very, very important. It's having people with disabilities in my community as part of that, it's diversity. I don't know why, it's one of those things, but community care is autonomy, guaranteed income, obviously accessibility, value position and visibility.
Thank you so much. And Keely, over to you. What could communities of care look like?
Yeah, so I think that the other two panelists touched on everything greatly, brilliantly. But yeah, so I think just to reiterate, I think interdependence like working together is key. I think autonomy and agency is key when we think about reimagining care. I also think that it's really important that, disabled people are able to make decisions about their futures and about regardless if it's the care they receive, the career they decide to do, whether they decide to work at all, just like anyone should, people with disabilities should be able to be the contributors to their futures and be understood as having the agency to know themselves, what works for them, what doesn't. And so for me, reimagining care is really about interdependence, autonomy, agency, and really working towards empowering and dismantling hierarchies between ability and disability.
Beautiful. And Melissa just said that collectives and communities of care are so radical because it would reduce surveillance. And that's a really good point. Love all the Foucauldian nods today. I do want to be mindful of time for questions and our timesheet that our very organized Carly has set us to. So I might close the formal part there and open it up to a brief couple of questions and any remarks from Carly, if that's okay with everybody.
Yeah, sorry guys. We don't have time for questions, but we do have time for absolutely shameless promotions. If you do have any questions, feel free to send it to the team. We will redirect it. Because I know some of you have to go right at, I think it's 2 p.m. your time. So here are a few shameless promotions, but again, we can redirect questions. So before you go, a few quick, cool, and fun things Needs is getting up to. Join us on November 9th at 3 p.m. EDT as we celebrate Indigenous Disability Awareness Month with new abilities. The registration info will be coming out soon. The first leg of the State of the Schools tour kicks off late next month with stops in St. John's, Newfoundland, and Halifax, Nova Scotia. Needs Back to School campaign remains ongoing, and student submissions detailing their experiences and opinions on a totally biased here, largely in person, unsafe, and inaccessible fall 2022 term are warmly welcomed. I also know like all of you get a billion survey requests, but I am going to ask you to fill out another one. We're looking for some event feedback just to make sure that this is relevant for you, meaningful, and just a good fun time. So if you have the time, we'd really appreciate it. And the info does actually get used. And finally, just to make sure you do not miss a thing, follow us on our social media or sign up to the Needs newsletter for all more info. And I'm just going to put a ton of links in the chat. And with that, we can stop recording.